So it is really good to see such a big crowd anyway on a Saturday afternoon when time's valuable. So definitely appreciate everybody coming. Do we have anybody that's here for the first time? Hopefully not the last. All right, we've got a few new people. If you do have any questions, there is a question and answer period a little later on. But if you don't get questions answered and you do have questions, please find one of the three of us. We have Janina over here, who's the adoptions person. I'm the executive director, so I basically don't know anything, so don't ask me anything. And we also have Kathy Udiger, who is somewhere. Probably picked on her during a washroom bathroom break. All right, so we have quite a lot to get through today, and we have some amazing refreshments that Brenda brought in, so thank you for that. They all have tortoises on the little cupcakes, and I'm really at a disadvantage here by being at the front and they're at the back, so if I run and knock anybody over, apologies for doing that. We'll get on to the agenda, and I need to look at it as well because I can't remember what it is. We're going to go through just a few brief things of what we've been doing in the last month. Then I'll turn it over to Kathy, and she'll do her questions and stories, quick tip for the mid-June to mid-July care. And then we'll have those great refreshments that will be gone in about 60 seconds. And then we have Jennifer Parsons here, who is the nutritionist at the San Diego Zoo. So she's going to be giving us a great, we know from last month's newsletter, if you read last month's newsletter, she wrote the article that's in that, and you're going to get that plus much more. So we'll start with a little report on our trip to Northern Nevada. Last month, we were just about to go to Northern Nevada, to Reno, and what a great trip it was. Beautiful place, great people, and 91 people at the first workshop. So my arms were kind of tired after lugging chairs around because we put out 40 chairs. And as people were coming in, it just became, where are we going to put them all? So unfortunately, we couldn't go two tiers, but it was a lot of people, a lot of people interested in what we were doing. We did a few interviews on the radio and on the television, so I think that kind of helped. And then the next day, we had 56 people at our Gardnerville one. Seven adoptions already there, and 11 people are working with Janina to get their gardens ready. Huge variation in yards up there. You go to people and they say they've got a tiny yard and it turns out to be 6.5 acres. So it was a lot of fun seeing all the different properties that people have, and just talking to new people about getting some tortoises up there. So I guess now we have to move some tortoises up there now that we've started this. And we're also starting a chapter of tortoise group up there. So next month, I think we'll be going back again to do some more workshops, take some tortoises up there, do some adoptions, and just help get their group off the ground. Oh, we do have a, I don't know whether this is going to, this is one of the tortoises that was adopted up in, I don't even know if this is going to work. It is a video, and it doesn't look like it's going to play for us. But it's not that it's a really spectacular video. But you yourself know once you've adopted a tortoise, you're excited, and they sent us a video of their tortoise eating. So, but it is online if you really want to check it out. So far this year we've done 17 adoptions locally. Still have lots of tortoises to move around, including those from the backyard breeding sites. I don't know if anybody saw the television interview that I did on Channel 3 with Mike Sen from Fish and Wildlife, talking about how we have a problem of people breeding tortoises and then they live a long time, somebody dies, and then you've got, well, they said originally 17 tortoises. When we were there, we counted 24, and it turned out it was 34. So lots of tortoises just in one backyard that we're trying to find homes for. And so some of those are going north. Some of them, we're not sure. Everybody here has one, so I'd say, does anybody want a tortoise? But you all already have them. And as I mentioned, we did some interviews on the backyard breeding issue, including an article in the local newspaper. The t-shirts are in. Some of them are out because we don't have any larges or extra larges left, so I think we're going to have to put a new order in very, very shortly, i.e. Monday. There are still some at the back if you want to take a look, and as Kathy already mentioned, sizing is a little bit on the big side, but then when you wash them, they do shrink to normal sizes. The 2XL looks as though it's the size of a bed cover, but it really does shrink in a little bit. So they're in, and they're selling fast. That's not my little pitch. They really are selling fast. So what's coming up? We are going to be planning more adoption workshops, as I mentioned, up in the north. We hope we're going to do one in Pahrump as well, and we may even do another one here, maybe Henderson, Boulder City, and maybe also in Las Vegas. So if anybody is interested in those, we'll certainly be doing another adoption workshop. We'll be transporting tortoises to Reno in July. We haven't figured out exactly how yet. The U.S. Postal Service was not keen on just putting a stamp on the shell, and I don't know why that is. But in August, we're going to be assisting with a sterilization clinic that's going to be taking place here in Las Vegas, and that's going to be a collaboration between Nevada Department of Wildlife, the Fish and Wildlife Services, ourselves, and there's going to be vets from across North America coming to show people how to do sterilization of tortoises. It's not something that's kind of like spaying or neutering a cat or a dog that's been done for many, many years. So we're having people come in to teach local vets how to do sterilizations, and we're going to be involved in helping out with that clinic as well, which is going to be very interesting to watch. There's going to be, apparently, there's going to be six stations of people doing sterilizations, so it's going to be kind of neat to watch. And we're going to be also helping with getting tortoises to all the different stations, and we may need some volunteers for that if anybody is interested in helping out with that. And that's, I think, dates haven't exactly been decided. It's either the 26th and the 27th or the 27th and the 28th of August. We're also working on some education programs, including some programs to use tortoises for therapy for autistic children. So that's something else that we're just at the initial stages of working on getting a program off the ground for that. And our next meeting is on July the 19th, when we have a couple of people that we've probably not had at any meetings before giving a talk. I'm not sure who Kathy and Janina are, but they're probably going to do a good job for us anyway. They're going to be talking about creating and upgrading a tortoise habitat, and that's going to be the July meeting. And you can get information online, all the different things that we're doing, and also all the different events that we have. And they're also in the newsletter as well, which has changed a little bit from last month. I think the next one is Kathy. So I'll get out of the way and you can listen to Kathy. She's probably going to want the other microphone, right?
Yes, I guess.
Thanks, Jim. Wow. I tell you, isn't this fabulous? There's so much going on. And I was just telling somebody on the way in that the Fish and Wildlife Service has so much going on with tortoises, and they'll be going, oh gosh, how are we going to, wait, tortoise group can do that. And then another thing will come up and they'll say, ooh, tortoise group could do that. And we can. And it's just wonderful. And they want to pay us to do it too, which is very nice. Let me see here. Is this Hustle? Is Hustle's, are Hustle's parents here? No? I just want to point out that this, I think, is a Tacoma, isn't it? A honeysuckle? And it's something I'm not going to look at later, so I just wanted you to point that out. My tortoise likes those very much. Does anyone else have one of these? It's a honeysuckle of some sort, and they called mine a Tacoma, but you know they have names, all kinds of names. Powell, would you just kind of move the top down so that those folks in the back don't have to look over the top? Little thanks. I think that's in there. Thank you. Oh, okay. Well, that was wrong. I'll just go at it this way. Okay, are there any new adopters here? You got your tortoise. Anybody else have anybody else a brand new tortoise? Okay, so three of you, would you think of one cute little thing to tell us in a few minutes?
Brief.
Mm-hmm. Now, I have very exciting news. In September, we're having our biannual elections for the officers of the board and board members. And so if anybody is interested in being on the board or being an officer, chairman, vice chairman, secretary, treasurer, this is a time to talk to me about that. A year ago we started on this new plan. We did the strategic plan, we worked hard, we found an executive director, and our next big push is to get a board that's really functioning as a board. So, is there anybody that just says, oh boy, I love to do that? Well, I hope so. If you even are thinking about it, please just let me know. And we'll have those elections, as I said, in September. Another thing is we're looking for a location to do our mega diet bagging. That'll probably be coming up in another month or so. We can't use the school at this time of year. And we need a big spot. So does someone belong to a church maybe that has a big room we could use on a Saturday, or know of a place where it's big, you know, like the big multipurpose room at a school is perfect. So if anybody, does anybody just think of a place right offhand? Well, we had 70 people crammed into that little room, remember? It was very difficult coordinating it there, but they are available to use if we need to. Well, again, if you think of a place, just email us and let us know. This time, Brenda brought some amazing refreshments, as you will see, with little logos and tortoises on them. Is there somebody who's willing to bring the refreshments for next time? You know, there aren't any hands going up. Zip. And it takes a lot of folks to run this. Nancy, you brought some this, that's right. Nancy brought some this time too. Will somebody else join Nancy? Oh, Audrey, you're a jewel. Thank you. Whew, let's give those girls a hand. And Brenda. Now, for people who are here and interested in adoptions, are there any people who don't have tortoises and are here to learn about adoption? You all have tortoises. Well, for when people talk to you about it, please refer them to Janina and ask them to start the process by just going to our website and putting in an adoption application. Janina gets right back to them and then they can start. Well, Jim mentioned the overbreeding or the backyard breeding, and I want to just mention again, please separate the sexes. Don't let the males and the females breed. It's a terrible problem that we have. There's no place for tortoises to go. Marilyn is just telling me she lives at Las Ventanas, which is a retirement place. You wouldn't think those old tortoises would be procreating now, would you? But that's, you know, people will come by. She said the mailman came by at a hatchling and said, here, you're the tortoise lady, take it. Which is what happens. And there's no place for tortoises to go now. We're all working on trying to find a resolution for that. But really, we need to literally nip it in the bud and separate the sexes, not allow the procreation. What a crowd we've got here. Wowie. How many do we have, Pam?
61.
61. It looks like 161 to me. Holy smokes. How great. Thank you all for coming today and happy summer. It is the summer solstice, so this is the longest day of the year, and that's affecting our tortoise behavior, isn't it? The tortoises are out at different times, and what I like to look at each month is how the behavior is changing, because that's what's so much fun about your tortoise, is watching how it changes because of the sun, because of the temperature, and the plants, and so on. So here we are. Now, I did this a couple of days ago when it was mild, which it isn't anymore. So I just want to look at what's changed between last month and this month. So, okay, there it is. So last month, they were coming out and they had to bask for a while before they started eating. Right now, my tortoise comes right out and goes right to it. He doesn't bask at all, because he's already at the temperature he needs to be. They were browsing like crazy and eating like mad in April and May, and now, well, it's slowed down a little. That's all I can say. And maybe that has to do with what's available. Last month, it was really hot, and so I was thinking summer. You know, they were emerging early and going in early, and then it got cool. So now my tortoise is hanging out in his burrow. He was, until this morning. He was hanging out in his burrow, and he'd move up in increments. The burrow's 8 feet long, so he'd move up, and he'd just sit there until it got to be about over 80 degrees outside, which was kind of late in the day until all last week and the week before. So that was quite a change from before. And also the nesting activity. If you have a female, she's probably laid by now if she's going to, but not always. And if she is laying a second clutch, she could be doing that a little bit later. Does anyone have a female that's laid? And the eggs could be...
My sister.
What's she planning to do with the eggs?
Fry them.
Cheryl says fry them, they're good.
The tortoise never buried them, she just laid them and then just kind of walked away.
Oh good, then they won't incubate properly. Well, that's a good resolution for that, because we really don't want her to have hatchlings.
She's never been with a male.
Some females will lay infertile eggs, and even if they've never been with a male, so good, they would have been infertile anyway. Well, that's good to know. If you have a female and she's digging and not producing any eggs, and then she's digging and not producing any eggs and squatting, and this is bad. She's probably egg bound, and after a couple of weeks you would want to take her to the vet. And they can do things. They can give her a stimulant, I think it is, to try to cause the eggs to come out. But if they're really bound up, that would require surgery. Otherwise it's going to have a very negative result. We had a tortoise die at a school last year who had a problem with that. And it's, you know, females die in childbirth all the time, and not just humans. Oh, look at who. That's Tad. I lured him out because I wanted a picture, and he really wasn't ready, but dandelions, you know what they will do. So I want to look at burrow temperature a little bit. As I said, my tortoise is staying in the burrow until it's about 85 degrees. Now, inside the burrow, down at the far end, it's about 72 degrees, or it was. And then I measured his temperature when he was near the opening of the burrow, and his body temperature on his skin was 75 degrees. So he wasn't really very warm yet. Tortoises really start working and digesting at about 85 degrees, healing. So they, if you don't see them when it's 70 degrees, there's a good reason for it. Now, my guy comes out, and depending upon the light and the temperature, he does his thing, and then around noon, he goes back in like he knows it's time for a nap or something. Doesn't matter what the temperature is. How about you guys? Does yours do that too? It's the darndest thing. It just doesn't seem to be temperature related at all. Yes?
Yeah, I thought we had a lazy tortoise because, I mean, some days he'd come out of the burrow, walk, look around, say no thanks, and go back in. We won't see him for the rest of the day.
Well, it's maddening, isn't it?
Yes,
especially if you have food there and stuff. But they know what they like to do. So you may wonder how I know what the temperature is. And I finally broke down and bought this toy. I've been wanting this forever. Those of you who are in the trades probably have seen this. You can buy it at Harbor Freight or online. It's an infrared thermometer. See over there? That's 75 degrees there. And then there's his stomach. 80.5 degrees. And here's Frida. She's 74 degrees. And so I can just go like this and shoot down to the end of the burrow and know the temperature. Now, there are other ways to do this, but this is really fun. And fun is what you want to have with your tortoise. Well, I paid way too much for it. It was $35 or something like that. And a couple of years ago was $19.99. So I said, why didn't I buy it when they had Marv?
They're on sale this month at Harbor Freight, I think, for $19.99.
He says $19.99 at Harbor Freight. Harbor Freight, let's see, can I advertise Harbor Freight? Sure. And you can always get 20% off that too, but not sale things. There's a Harbor Freight on Rainbow at Westcliff and on South Decatur, just north of Trop. That's okay, it's very critical because it's fun toy. Now, you probably say, well, you know, I could put in an indoor-outdoor thermometer, but you people do that, or what I've done until now is I've just taped a thermometer on the end of a pole and I stuck it down there, but I never did it, you know, and then I, well, anyway, so this is a lot of fun, and so, of course, what you really want to do is you want to keep a log, because it's also very interesting and instructive to learn what the temperature is in your burrow. The average temperature the other day when I was doing this was 83 degrees. The average temperature yesterday was 88 degrees. So that whole temperature, the whole earth temperature is heating up. What's yours, Powell? Did you look?
This morning it was 84. It got up to 88 one day this week. So it's right there.
Your burrow got up to 84? Yeah. Mine goes, I'm surprised at how much it fluctuates during the day because I thought the earth would really keep it within a narrower range, but not the case. So it's real interesting. Yeah, Brenda.
We had someone come fix our air conditioning, so they had it. They said, oh, since you're here, we're already paying you. And it was 100 degrees outside, and it was about 87
in the burrow. Nice. Afternoon, huh? Late afternoon. Okay, and Brenda has an above-ground burrow, and good. Good to know.
What is the ideal temperature?
Ideal? You'd have to ask a tortoise about that.
Well, they don't talk that much about you.
I don't know. Well, let's see. Do you think they want it to get cooler than 85? Maybe. I can't say. You know, if maybe I should think about what's going on in the desert. Nancy, there's a chair right up here. Oh, Pam's going to be there, yeah. I guess you would say maybe we could say what would be comfortable or what would work for a tortoise in the desert. And a tortoise in the desert's going to have a burrow that's maybe that deep. Lots of people have done that, and I don't know what they've said. Do you know, Jennifer? You know about burrow studies? Temperatures in burrows? There are huge variations. Sometimes tortoises are in very deep caliche dens, and those I think would remain pretty cool, but they can also survive in very shallow burrows, we know too. But not comfortably, I would say. But tortoises suffer a lot, unfortunately. So anyway, this is sort of a fun thing, and I just want to remind you to keep a log of things, which I'm not doing, but maybe you'll start, and that'll give me the impetus to do it. But I do have the, is that up here? Where the heck is it? Uh-oh. Anyway, the rumation entrance and exit dates, that's really important to keep a log of, because your tortoise will use the same dates every year. Like all of us, we have our own habits. And although the entrance and exit dates seem to be changing because of global warming, your tortoise is going to stay within a certain range anyway. So mine came out a week earlier this year, so I'm expecting him a week earlier next year too. And the height, the weight, and the length also. Now I'm going to harangue about browsing also, and this kind of goes into what Jennifer's talking about, and I've asked her to consider a question, and we don't have an answer for yet. Tortoises need a supply of plants for browsing as they would do in the desert, and what we've been saying is they need that so that they can eat when they want to and so they can be independent, which is especially important right now, because if you want to go on a vacation and your tortoise knows about browsing, it'll be just fine for you to go away for, well, you could go away for a week. You go away for, yeah. Would you? Dominique, no? Well, probably you would want someone to come and check on your new tortoise. But I know that my tortoise is fine. He wouldn't like it, maybe. But he's got plants everywhere, and he would be fine. And tortoises in the desert don't actually get that much to eat. So a tortoise can actually go without eating. So if you're thinking about doing something with your tortoise, leave it at home. Don't give it to a friend to take care of or think about boarding it or something else. They need to be in their own habitat where they know things. A variety of plants is an attractive part of your yard, and it's fun for the tortoise too. And they'll select different plants at different times of the year too. So if you put in a plant and you say, oh, my tortoise won't eat that, well, and it might not even eat it this year, but then maybe it'll eat it next year or the year after. It's the darndest thing. Someone gives you a plant because their tortoise just can't get enough of it, and yours won't eat it, but that's the way they are. So I made this little chart of what's going on in my yard, but I have pictures that show you better. The grapes are still good. The yellow trailing primrose is just starting to go crazy. The gazanias are going down. The dandelions are hardly doing anything. The petunias aren't doing much. The globe mallow's not doing much. Who's got Mexican evening primrose? Because is it doing well now, or
it's fading?
Is starting to fade too?
Yeah.
Well, the yellow trailing primrose, though, my God. My tortoise goes out every morning, and you can see where he is. You get about 15 or 20 new flowers every morning, and it's way down at the end. So I look down there, and it's like half gone. I know just where he is, because he just goes out every morning and mows it down. The desert willow that was just starting to bloom in May is just loaded now, and the hollyhocks are starting to go. Well, there's Tad in his grape leaf house. This is how it looked this week. See, he can hang out down in here, eat all his stuff, and just sit in there, have a nice little house to play in. Those aren't doing much. These are just going crazy. Those are the same ones from April. Here's globe mallow from May, and here it is now with just a couple of little things on it. This tree is just loaded with blossoms. Each one of those is a handful, and you can just pick those and give them to your tortoise. And it's interesting. Mine will eat grape leaves first, hollyhocks next, then desert willows if he feels like it. And he used to just eat desert willows like crazy, but his favorite are the grape leaves, and that varies, I know, from person to person, tortoise to tortoise person. Now, you can't see this too well, but in here are the hollyhocks growing up into this tree. There's one over here that's almost, there are just a couple of little flowers because it's out in the sunlight. But this one that's within the tree and still in the shade is growing like crazy, growing way up into here. So I've got a lot of shade in my yard now, and it's made a big difference with the plants. So what are we looking at? Tortoises are going into a summer mode now. It's not hot, hot summer, so we aren't expecting midsummer behavior yet. That's coming up later. My tortoise is starting to pace, and then he rests in the afternoon, then he comes out later. Kind of in between behavior, nothing exciting right now. Any questions about what your tortoise might be doing or why it's doing what it's doing, Marv?
George has taken to sleeping on the patio right by the back door. Is it because his burrow's too hot?
Oh, well, Marv asks why George is sleeping on the patio by the back door. Did you ask him?
I did, and all he said was he wanted to come in.
Yeah,
that's right.
He wants to come in.
I taught him how to use the dog door last year.
Oh, that was smart.
But I opened it this year because I wanted him to find all the plants I planted.
And you think he forgot where the dog door was after you taught him? And he made ramps for him. Uh-huh. Oh.
Sleeping at night on the patio instead of in the burrow.
Okay, sleeping on the patio. Well, that's interesting because the patio, how warm do you think the surface of the patio is at night?
Well, it's in the shade. Yeah. It's in the shade all day, so it's not that hot. And he sleeps right against the top.
Well, it's kind of cozy then, huh?
He sleeps with his head in the corner.
Yes.
And he's got his head in the corner. Well, he likes it there. So it isn't yet 110 there. And tortoises, as we're going to find out next month, when it gets really hot during the summer, the burrow is still hot when the tortoise goes in. So let's say by 8 o'clock at night, it's still really hot in the burrow, but outside the temperature is starting to cool. So by about 10 o'clock, there's a reversal. It's hotter in the burrow than it is outside, and then your tortoise may well come outside and sleep outside because they're really sharp about what's going to be best for them. They want to make it easiest for their bodies to work, and so they're going to come outside, and then bright and early in the morning, they go back in the burrow. So he's figured out something that feels good for him. I wouldn't say it's because he doesn't like the burrow or there's something wrong with it. George is new to his burrow, so he hasn't been through a summer yet. And Marv rescued him from having lived all his life in a terrarium.
Oh my God.
And he's
About 8 inches.
So he's having some adjustment issues, I would imagine. Probably needs a tortoise shrink. Don't you think?
Yeah.
Any tortoise shrinks here? He want to go in the house. No, he needs to learn to live outside. And he can visit in the house, but he really needs to live outside. Okay. Now, what are the custodians doing at this time of year? So hopefully we're picking up scats, hosing in the urine, checking for any litter in the yard, any little bright things that tortoises might eat, chunks of just awful stuff blows right into your yard. Soak your tortoise occasionally. If you don't see it doing it itself, it's a good idea to soak it now and then. And update your tortoise log. And here's my boy again. You'll notice I've finally put a mark on him. This is my phone number in case he should escape. So that's it for my little talk. We're going to have a break now, and we'll be back, not at 2 o'clock, 2:10, 2:15, something like that, at which time Jennifer Parsons is going to talk to us about this fascinating, fascinating topic of nutrition and diet, and you will be amazed. Now, I want to thank Brenda for making these incredible cupcakes with our logo and little tortoises on them. And for those of you who are healthy, you can have an apple or cherries and enjoy. And thank you, Brenda. See you in a few minutes. Now, on to the main event, and here she is, ta-da, all the way from San Diego, just got off the plane with her husband, Joe, Jennifer Parsons from Dr. Jennifer Parsons from the San Diego Zoo, and I'm going to let her tell you all about the fabulous nutrition stuff she's been doing. Jennifer.
Thanks, Kat. Okay. Well, thank you guys for having me. If you were here a couple years ago, I gave a very similar talk, so hopefully I won't bore you too much, but I'm really happy to be back. I'm going to share a little bit of new information, but in general, I just wanted to kind of give the same sort of information for folks who might be new, especially you new owners or new custodians, I'm sorry. So Kathy asked me to tell you guys a little bit about me. My background is actually mainly in those pesky mammals. I just finished my PhD work last year on giant panda nutrition, so basically a PhD in bamboo. And then when I graduated, I was like, yay, I'm done with that, except I work at the San Diego Zoo, so guess what I work with all day now? Bamboo and pandas. But that's okay. I know. It's just a burden. But before that, I did a master's degree in small mammals, so wild rodents in the Tallgrass Prairie in Oklahoma, and also their nutrition. And then before that, I got a bachelor's degree in animal science at Colorado State, so mainly domestic animals. And it's been cool because all of those different things that I learned about in my academic background have kind of blended together into the work that I do now with zoo animals at the San Diego Zoo. And even though a lot of my work, my personal research has been in mammals, they interestingly have really similar diets and therefore really similar systems to the guys that we're talking about today, because they're all herbivores. And at the, you know, as a nutritionist, I basically see every animal as a little walking digestive system. So in that respect, they're really, really similar to tortoises as well. So just to tell you a little bit about my department, so I'm at San Diego Zoo Global, which is the new umbrella term for our organization. It's mainly to highlight the work that we do not only at our two campuses in San Diego, the zoo and the safari park, but also to point out that we do have satellite locations around the U.S., you know, the one here in Las Vegas that we've been managing for the past 5 years at the Desert Tortoise Conservation Center. And then we also have conservation programs in Hawaii with endangered birds there, on San Clemente Island off of San Diego with the endangered shrike program there. And we just took over a field station in Peru that's quite a large preserve that they have down there, and we took over the research station there. So our department, because of that, works with not only the animals on our two campuses, but we also do consulting with a lot of those satellite programs. And maybe one day I can talk them into flying me to Peru. But I've been working pretty closely with the DTCC here for the past 5 years. I started at San Diego just about 5 years ago, right after we had taken over administration of that center. So, and I was really excited from the get-go to get to work with desert tortoises. A lot of my good friends in grad school are herpetologists, and so I picked up everything that I could from them as I went. And so I really have an affinity for these guys. They're really great critters. And then we also do some consulting with other zoos around the country through our nutrition consultation program. So it's really, really great information flow amongst many different locations and institutions. So, see if I can work the technology. So when we talk about providing appropriate diets to captive animals, especially the tortoises in captivity, providing an appropriate diet for your animals has a lot of key healthcare implications to animals in a variety of situations. So not only animals in zoos and aquaria, or those that, you know, that are in the care of custodians like yourselves, but also animals in translocation and rehabilitation programs. And we all know that this is quite on the rise, especially here in Clark County. Basically, the end story is that we should be treating animals in each of these categories in very similar ways, and I'll get into that in a little bit. But and it is important to manage the diet, especially animals that are about to go back into the wild, in a way that will prepare them for the environment they're going to encounter. But then when you extrapolate backwards, we should also be taking care of the animals in our own backyards in a similar way. Emulating the wild environment is the best policy when it comes to these guys. So because of my work with the DTCC, a lot of my focus has been recently on the nutritional ecology of the Mojave populations of desert tortoise. But the information I'll present today also applies to a number of other xeric or desert-adapted herbivore specialists among the tortoises. That includes the Sonoran population of desert tortoises, as well as several other tortoise species. So you've got your leopard tortoises, sulcatas, pancake tortoises, Mediterranean spurthied, Bolson tortoises. These guys all live in a very similar habitat. It's dry, it's really variable, and they eat much of the same food sources. They're all basically grazers on dry grasses and occasional supplementing with other types of nutritious foods, but the base of their food is really dry grasses a lot of the time. It's also important to note that not all tortoises are the same. So my talk today is going to apply specifically to these specialist grazer tortoises. But it's important, especially when you're looking at recommendations for feeding them, that you pay attention to just those recommendations for herbivorous tortoises. Because there are other tortoises out there that live in more tropical jungle situations that have a different diet. And I'll touch really briefly on that. But just be careful when you're looking at information out there in pet stores and stuff that you're recognizing that these are specialist herbivores. So the key to formulating a captive diet for any exotic species, and this is kind of the mainstay of what I do at work, if someone were to hand me a species that I'd never seen before and ask me how to feed it, the very first question I would ask is, well, where does it live and what does it do in its wild habitat? Because first and foremost, you want to look at their natural history and their nutritional ecology and try to copy that as closely as you can. It's really important to remember that every animal's digestive tract and their metabolism and their physiology are all the result of adaptation over sometimes thousands of years to a specific set of environmental conditions in a specific habitat. And for many species, especially those that in terms of evolutionary time have not been with us in captivity that long, they're still adapted to that wild habitat. You know, their genes haven't caught up and their bodies haven't caught up to living in backyards. So it is really important to keep that in mind and treat them in a similar way, even when you're caring for them yourselves. So straying outside of that nutritional environment to which they're adapted can have some consequences in terms of their health, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. So let's talk about that wild habitat. The habitat of free-ranging tortoises, and it's really easy for, you know, this is a great place for me to come and give this talk because you guys don't have to, I don't have to tell you what their habitat's like. You live in their habitat. You see it all around you. It's a little bit different than when I'm giving this same talk in San Diego to desert tortoise owners who are, you know, they're not, you know, in the middle of it all. So, you know, as you know well, desert tortoises in the Mojave experience a really dry and unpredictable environment. In the western portion of their range, so over towards California in the shadow of the mountains, there's only a single rain event in the winter. And then you see kind of a gradation as you go eastwards. So when you get into the Sonoran population in Arizona, there's pretty predictable summer monsoons. And here you're kind of in between. You know, sometimes you get the summer rain, sometimes you don't. So in any case, the limiting resource for these guys is, of course, their water availability, which in the wild they get mainly through their food and sometimes through those ephemeral ponds that'll pop up after a rain. But overall, there's not a really big abundance of above-ground plants. A lot of desert plants have really extensive below-ground systems, but that doesn't help an animal that's living on top of the ground. So, and of those above-ground plants that are there, a lot of them are mainly monocots, which are the grasses, and some succulents. Those are pretty dominant in desert systems. And a lot of those plants have adaptations to defend themselves against herbivores, whether that be toxins or spines or some kind of defense. Because the plants are fighting the same battle. They don't have a lot of resources either, and it's really hard for them to live. And so, you know, just to compete, they have to defend themselves against all the other host of things that are trying to take advantage of them as a scarce resource. So I'm pretty fascinated by the whole plant-animal coevolution that happens, because the minute a plant gets eaten, it'll evolve a defense, and then the animal will evolve a defense against that, and it's a really interesting little arms race that happens. So the main part of their diet consists of leaves and the flowering parts of monocots, which are those grasses again, and also some dicots, which are herbs and shrubs, and they use both annual and perennial plants out in the wild. They do occasionally consume succulents, mainly for water balance. And thank you, Kathy, you gave me an introduction to that topic already. But in the wild, when they do eat succulents, they do it through a really careful selection process. And now you know why. Because a lot of succulents have really high levels of those oxalates, which are chemical compounds that can bind up calcium and make it unavailable. If they eat too much and it binds up too much calcium, it can actually precipitate out in the form of calcium oxalate crystals. And that can form. Sometimes animals that have bladder stone problems originates from that problem, or it can occur in other parts of the body. And so it can be quite detrimental. But the cool part, and we touched on this already, about animals living out there in the wild, is they're really good about knowing what they need and knowing what's bad for them. And so they kind of evolve this process of they can detect these oxalates, usually through taste. They taste quite bitter. And they can select just enough of a succulent to manage their water balance without going too far over and getting too much oxalate. So animals out there are super smart about how to manage all these different constraints on their environment. And then during the driest parts of the year, when the annuals are already consumed or they've died off and the perennials are, you know, down hibernating underneath the ground, then tortoises do the same thing. You know, they rely on brumation, which is a state of metabolic shutdown, to survive until the next period of plant production. I had a professor in my master's program who did his career with studying desert tortoises, and he always liked to say that desert tortoises aren't really desert adapted, because when it gets too tough in the desert, they just go down their burrow. So what they're really good at is maintaining that, you know, 85 or so degrees, that just the right environment that's good for them. And then when it gets too harsh, they escape. And so, they're super good at managing their internal body temperature by working all those temperature gradients. And so that's why burrows are cool, because it presents a temperature gradient and they can seek out just what's the right environment for themselves. So this is a little chart of a workup of the nutritional composition of their wild diet. This was this is a table taken from A.C. Highfield of the Tortoise Trust in London. He has a really good website with a lot of good diet information if you ever need that on tortoises in general. So he put this together from a diet survey on wild Mojave Desert tortoises that was done by Hansen et al. In 1976. It was one of the first overall surveys of their diet. And so I've listed out the different main components of their diet, and I've also put some reference values up there for you just so you can kind of see what scope we're talking about. So the first thing that you see there is that the proportion of dietary protein is super low. And I've pointed out here, so for a strict carnivore, they're eating probably about 20% protein in their diet. Most omnivores are 15%. So those really strict herbivores are usually around 10 to 12% protein in their diet, and that's what we do see in the wild tortoises and kind of towards the bottom end of that. which is to be expected for a desert adapted animal. Protein is one of those other nutrients that's really in shortage in the desert. The crude fiber in their diet, you can see there, is really, really high. We usually don't see it much higher than this in a wild foraging population. So the stuff that they're eating is quite fibrous. And again, it's similar to the best known grazers, which include things like cattle, horses, rabbits. So they really are little grazers. You see pretty low quantities of lipid in their diet, and not a lot of fat out there, not a lot of resources in general. And it's interesting that even on this wild diet, you think resources are pretty sparse, they are still able to meet their published requirements for calcium and phosphorus for other reptiles. Sometimes tortoises in the wild do that through their food. Sometimes they do that through utilization of opportunistic resources. So I was at the Desert Tortoise Council meeting a couple years ago. And a gentleman stood up and gave a really cool account of, it was kind of an informal study that he'd done on his own property, but he had a limestone outcropping, and he had watched his desert tortoises come and go to that outcropping and eat basically what's a really rich calcium source, and that's how they manage to balance their diet if they aren't quite getting it from the plants that they eat. So there isn't a lot of information on vitamin A and vitamin E for free-ranging desert tortoises. They're really hard vitamins to analyze out in the wild because they're a little bit labile. Once you sample the plant, they go away pretty quickly. But we will talk about that later and why that's probably not a huge concern for your guys if you're feeding them appropriately, which it sounds like a lot of you are. So we'll touch on that in a second. But first, let's talk about fiber, since that is a really significant component of their diet. So fiber is a type of carbohydrate. It's actually made up of exactly the same molecules as starches and sugars. However, there's a really important difference in the geometry of how these molecules are held together. So this molecule up here is amylose, which is the fancy name for starch. And this one down here is cellulose, which is one of the main types of fiber that you see in foods. And these molecules here, each of these molecules are exactly the same. The only difference is this bond here. So when you see it, and it's hard to represent here, but when you see it in a 3D form, these molecules would be just in a slightly different conformation respective to each other. And amazing how biology works, that makes all the difference in the world, because mammals, actually vertebrates, any kind of vertebrate, does not have any enzymes endemically in their bodies to break down that bond. So there are actually no vertebrates that are able to break down cellulose and utilize fiber. For some of us, like humans, that means that this types of fiber just passes through our bodies undigested, and that has important health benefits for us, in particular with the diet that we have, and that's why your doctor recommends that you eat fiber. But when you get a significant portion of your diet as fiber, you need to start getting nutritional value out of it, and so you need to figure out a way to do that. So does anyone know how tortoises do that? Or animals that use a lot of fiber in their diet is in general. If vertebrates can't do it, then who can? We'll talk about it. Microbes. So they get a little help from their friends, I like to say. So animals that do use fiber as a source of nutrition, 9 times out of 10, actually all of them, because you couldn't otherwise, have a resident population somewhere in their digestive tract of microbes, and that helps them break down their food. And this is sort of a symbiotic relationship that's evolved over thousands and thousands of years, and there's a few different ways to go about it. But we're talking about little populations of mainly protozoan bacteria. There's a few fungi and yeast thrown in. And it's through a process that we call fermentation. You're probably familiar with one type of fermentation. This is a little bit different, but it's actually quite similar. Fermentation is defined as transformation of one substance into another by means of microbial action. And instead of producing alcohol and gas, like the fermentation that we like, in the case of these types of microbes inside the GI tract, they make molecules that their host can use for energy. So they're doing the job that the tortoises can't do for themselves. And also fermentation, even in animals, results in gas, which you know if you've been around cattle. And then also the cool thing about these microbes is that when the bugs reach the end of their life cycle, their bodies themselves can pass through the GI tract, go down and get digested themselves by the host, and they provide a really good source of protein. So a tortoise gets a good deal of its protein, too, from this little resident population of microbes. Now, most of you are probably familiar with the multiple chambers that cattle will have in the front end of their GI tract. The big one, the rumen, is that little environment in which all their microbes live. And in cattle, it's really highly developed, and it's really extensive. There's people that make an entire career out of studying the little microcosm inside a cattle rumen. And so those types of species that have it in the front end of their GI tract are called foregut fermenters. Some animals have that little resident population in the end of their GI tract, so after their stomach and everything else. And those are called hindgut fermenters. And tortoises fall into that category. So I put up a few representations here of different types of digestive tracts. And it's cool to look at these pictures because you can usually look at the anatomy of an animal's GI tract and how complex it is and pretty much figure out what they eat just by looking at their anatomy. So in general, the less digestible the diet, the more complicated the GI tract. The more digestible the diet, the simpler the tract. So for comparison, this is the tract of an eastern diamondback rattlesnake. So that's an obligate carnivore. They eat nothing but protein, which is a really pretty digestible food source. So you can see their tract is pretty simple. It's just kind of a straight tube. There's really not a lot of outpouching, not a lot of, you know, adaptations. And it's pretty short in terms of its overall body length. In the middle here, we've got a red-footed tortoise, which is more of a tropical omnivore. So they eat both fruits and plants and a variety of things. And again, to point out that not all tortoises are the same, this is one of those that's not a strict herbivore. But you can start to see a little bit of complexity. The tract is a little bit longer relative to its body size. And you're starting to see these little sacculations or little bumpies along the side there. That's an indication that there's a little bit something more going on. They have a little structure here called the cecum, which is kind of the same thing as our appendix, and that helps too with some digestive functions. And then you get over here to an iguana, which is a strict herbivore. And you can ignore this. This is actually their bladder and their reproductive tract, so ignore that there. But the rest of their GI tract is starting to get a lot of these types of sacculations. And again, a little bit longer in the hindgut. This is another hindgut fermenter, so their colon is a lot longer. And then this here is a desert tortoise. And even compared to the iguana, which is always held up in the nutrition literature as, you know, the poster child for herbivory, this is like the champion. So you've got all these little sacculations. And what this means is the fact that their colon is longer and has all these little ridges and things, and those are perfect little nooks and crannies for all the microbes to hang out in. So that the main flow, when food passes through them, goes through the main channel, but the microbes don't get washed out because they can live in those little pockets and continue to do their job. And then when they die, they'll fall into the main in the main passage and get digested and get washed out. So having this time, this type of symbiotic relationship has a lot of really important implications for your tortoise. Basically, the key to keeping a healthy animal in terms of your tortoise is all about keeping those microbial populations happy. And so when you're feeding your animal, you always want to keep track of, you know, keep in the back of your head, what is it that the microbial population wants? And if you meet that need, then you'll be meeting your whole animal needs pretty well. So what do the microbial population want? They want, first of all, a source of food, which is that fiber that we talked about. So for them, fiber is their primary source of food for those bugs. And next, they want a consistent environment because microbes need time to respond to change. And that's mainly because microbes' only way of changing is by adaptation of successive generations of microbes. So an individual bacterium can't really do much if their environment changes. But it can, you know, go on to produce different types of bacteria as it reproduces. And so it's important to keep the environment inside your tortoise pretty consistent. The best way to do that is to feed your, is to have similar items available to your tortoise on a day-to-day basis. And if you have a backyard set up with, you know, consistent plantings of different types of plants, that's already a pretty consistent environment. And we'll talk about ways to make the rest of their diet consistent as well. And then if you ever do need to do a diet change, which we sometimes have to do in the zoo, for example, if we receive an animal from another institution that's on a slightly different diet or something like that, then you want to make those changes gradually over the course of at least a week or so for any animal that is that has fermentation going on in its GI tract. And this goes not only for your tortoise, but for your horse or your rabbit or, you know, anything that depends on that microbial source. And it works good for your dogs and cats too. You know, any animal, you don't really want to change your diet suddenly. But it's even more important for these guys that rely on microbes. Having these microbes around also means you want to be really conscious of food items that are too rapidly fermented. And that's mainly the starches and the sugars we want to be careful of. because those microbes are made to break apart really difficult to digest types of food items, you know, like cellulose and things like that. So if they get a hold of items, especially carbohydrates that are a lot easier to digest, then they kind of have a party and they kind of go crazy. And so they can multiply really rapidly. They can produce their byproducts really rapidly. So the gas that they produce, they also produce acids as a byproduct. And so that can multiply too rapidly. And all that, if it happens faster than the host animal can deal with it, can build up in their body in ways that can be unhealthy. Who here has horses? Any horse owners? Well, even though you don't. So when this type of process happens in your horse, what do we usually call that? Colic, yeah. And we call it the exact same thing in tortoises. They have exactly the same capacity to colic if you change the diet too quickly towards a starchy type substrate, or if you feed too much of a starchy, sugary substrate. I'll get into that in just a second, yeah. But yeah, I'll put up my big no-no list. Don't feed this. So yeah, and we also call it bloat in a tortoise, but colic is really the technical term for this type of overproduction of gas, especially in the hindgut. In cattle, we talk about bloat in the rumen, and that's more of a foregut process. So what happens when tortoises are not an optimal diet? So the biggest problems we usually see stem from either insufficient fiber or too much protein in the diet, or both. It usually comes hand in hand. You know, you get more fiber, you get less protein, and it kind of, it's hard for one food item to have too much of both. It just doesn't work out with the math. But so as we discussed, not enough fiber in the diet can lead to poor stool quality or colic, which can then in turn lead to secondary opportunistic infections in the intestine or in the cloaca. A lot of dietary protein, especially in young growing animals, can lead to inappropriately rapid growth. And that can result, even if the animal's otherwise okay, in animals that reach sexual maturity way too early. It can end up with aggression as a result of that. And they're starting to get into that in the literature of what that progression is, but it seems to be a cascade of hormones that results in an animal that's just too amped up, too aggressive towards other animals. And you've also, if anyone here owns a large breed dog, you've also probably heard this caution too, that too much protein in a young growing animal can result in growth that's too fast with a lot of repercussions. Another big important thing to consider if you do have young growing animals, and this group is super good about promoting this, so I don't think you guys have any problems, but you need to make sure that species appropriate brumation is allowed to happen. Because when we really see the perfect storm is when someone has an animal that's a hatchling that's being fed too much protein, and they're keeping it up all winter and continuing to feed it, and it just grows entirely too fast. And so what you see as a result, especially if that animal that's growing a little too quickly isn't receiving adequate calcium and phosphorus to supply, the tissues that it's building too quickly, is you start to see metabolic bone disease and or pyramiding. I should also note that this can also happen if you've got plenty of calcium and phosphorus in the diet, but it's not exposed to sunlight. But again, this group, you guys are super good about keeping your animals outside where they're exposed to sunlight. Does anyone know why that might be? Vitamin D, yeah. So we get vitamin, all animals get vitamin D from sunlight exposure, and that's really important to the absorption and the utilization of both calcium and phosphorus, which are important for a number of things, including bone and shell development and things like that. So these are a couple of pictures that I took again from the Tortoise Trust website, but this is a little tortoise that had metabolic bone disease. It has the really characteristic flat carapace, and the plastron on these guys, we had a couple that were surrendered to the Desert Tortoise Center, and you start to get a little bit squishy on the underside of the plastron. So those are the classic signs. The other thing that I noticed, because I happen to be here in town when they receive these two animals, is the growth rings on each of their scutes were really widely spaced. So you could tell that these guys were growing really, really quickly, faster than they should. This is an animal with pretty classic pyramiding. Now, pyramiding is a little bit of a complex phenomenon, but inappropriate calcium in the diet is definitely a contributory factor. There's a number of other factors of husbandry that go into it, but that's a pretty big one. And then also a diet that's too high in protein, even if it's not in a younger animal, can lead to overproduction of uric acid, because that's, in a reptile, the main waste product for protein. So if they've got too much going in, it needs to go somewhere. They break it down to uric acid. If that gets produced in too much concentration, then that can lead to gout, which is a buildup of uric acid in sometimes the joints, sometimes the kidneys, sometimes various parts of the body, or it can lead to stone formation in the urinary tract. Now, stone formation is also a little bit complicated because there's also a dehydration component to it, but protein is at least a contributory factor, if not the main factor.
Is pyramiding from too much calcium or
too little? Too little. Yeah, along with a bunch of other things like humidity and temperature, and it's kind of a complex syndrome. Too little calcium can definitely contribute to it. And then the other thing we commonly see in captive diets is too much energy from either fat or protein can also contribute to obesity and the whole suite of problems that come with that. And that's also, overfeeding can also, just straight up overfeeding of even a good food source can lead to that too. And tortoises have the same problems from being overweight that we do, and for the same reasons. So, and this is, I swear, the only slide that's going to have this many numbers on it, but I just wanted to give you just kind of a comparison of a few different approaches to captive tortoise diets, and I'll just kind of walk you through this, and we'll look at some of the factors here. So the first column over here, just for comparison, is the wild diet that I showed you before, just so we can keep that in mind. The next four columns are all commercial diets that are labeled for tortoises. And I should say that all these numbers, except where I've indicated in a couple places, are all from our own analyses from samples that we in the nutrition department sent out to a lab to verify. So here we have tortoise diet A. This is actually sold as a single source diet. It's recommended on the label not to feed anything else except it. But you can start to see some of the problems that they've got going on here. There's a whole lot of protein and not enough fiber. And so this is one of those diets that we're talking about that might be inappropriate, especially for your strict herbivore types of tortoises. It's also got a little bit too much fat in it. So some of this would not necessarily be bad if there were other things in the diet, but it's the fact that it's sold as a single source. Here we have tortoise diet B, and that's a little bit better. The crude fiber is better. It's got a little bit less fat. It's got a pretty good balance of vitamins and minerals. But it does have this high protein. Now, the difference with this diet is it does say clearly on the label to feed with a good quality source of hay. And so when you add hay in with this, that boosts the fiber up a lot higher, brings the protein back down in kind of a dilution effect. And when you combine those two things, you come up with, this is our old historic diet at the zoo for our tortoises, for our herbivorous tortoises, including deserts and sulcatas and many others. Now you can see here, the protein's still a little high for my liking, and the crude fiber was still a little low. And there was a few things going on there that, it was funny, as a result of preparing this talk 2 years ago, I really started to look at this stuff. And so because I didn't quite like this diet so much, we're actually, last year, we went through a whole process of changing over our tortoise diets to be more like these guys in the middle. So technology is awesome. Feed technology is really evolving pretty quickly. And manufacturers have finally figured out a way to make a super high fiber, super low starch diet for really strict herbivores like tortoises. And so you see the result of it with diets C and D here. So we've got, especially in this one, protein that's really close to what you see in the wild, crude fiber that's really excellently high. But they're still able to supplement it with some of the, they've got really good levels of calcium and phosphorus here, and pretty good levels of vitamin A and E. Now, I should say, typically in the literature, and this is why this diet and this diet have about 300 IUs of vitamin E in it, that's usually what they recommend for most reptiles. However, the cool part about this diet C is that it includes a lot of grasses and other types of things that contribute these vitamins already. Vitamin A it does not, in this type of a diet, necessarily come straight from the grasses themselves, but it comes in the form of beta carotene. And a lot of reptiles and other animals that use an herbivore-based diet are really efficient at converting beta carotene over to vitamin A. There haven't been a lot of studies on desert tortoises per se, but we just assume as nutritionists that they have to be efficient at this process as well, because there is really no other source of vitamin A in their environment. So even if the diet that you're feeding doesn't have super, super high quantities of either vitamin A or vitamin E, if it either includes things like grasses or herbs or things that contribute on their own, or if you're supplementing their diet with the fresh browse that you've got in your backyards, then you're meeting those requirements pretty well. I put this analysis in here because when I was working with the Desert Tortoise Conservation Center, we needed to find a way to efficiently and inexpensively feed thousands and thousands of tortoises. So I started to look at, this is just a diet for herbivorous hoofstock that we feed to a lot of our animals at the zoo. And it's got, again, really similar profile. The bonus of this is it's sold in really, really big bags for not much money. So, we were trying to, again, find a way to economize things for them. We tried this out, but unfortunately we had some palatability issues. The animals just didn't want to eat it. So we actually backed off and went over to one of these two diets here. And I can tell you guys that as a nutritionist that works for a zoo, I can't recommend any brand in particular, but I can tell you where your diet falls, and it's right in here in Diet C. Yeah, in here.
Is that the new one?
The new one. Yeah. So you guys are doing really well with your diets. So.
Was that Diet C? It was hard to see.
Yeah. Yeah. I usually can't say what brand everything is, but Diet C is your stuff. Don't tell anyone I told you so. So I put this chart together to kind of give you a ballpark. I'm not here to recommend any brand in particular, but what I can do is arm tortoise custodians with the information to make the decisions for themselves and to look, I really encourage everyone, for your own food too, to look at the label on the back of your food and look at those nutrients and, for your animals as well, to compare that to their requirements and their needs. So these are just some general recommendations for any time you're selecting tortoise food. You want to try to keep the crude protein less than 15%. You want to keep the crude fiber really as high as you can get it. As high as you can go is always good. So 25 to 30 is great. Again, it's really hard for some manufacturers to do that, but some are developing the technology to do that, and it sounds like yours has. You want to keep the lipid around 2 to 4%, so pretty low, so you don't end up with too much energy and those obesity issues. Calcium should be greater than 1%, 1 to 1.5, if you can get it there. And then phosphorus, you want to keep your calcium to phosphorus ratio in about this ratio. You get too much phosphorus and it starts to interfere with the calcium. They kind of counterbalance each other. So you can actually induce the signs of a calcium deficiency just by having too much phosphorus relative to calcium. They play off each other a lot. And again, these are just the published recommendations for vitamin A and E for other reptiles. But again, if you're feeding any type of feed, especially one that's not heat extruded, which your pellet is not, it's not subject to a lot of heat in the processing, which means that it preserves a lot of the natural beta carotene and other things in there. In the pellets, or if you have them, if you have access to fresh growing plants, that's another good way to get those vitamins. So these are just some basic suggestions for the ingredients of a good desert tortoise diet, or really any tortoise that's subject to a similar habitat as desert tortoises. So first of all, just to make sure that you're meeting their mineral and vitamin requirements, mainly their mineral requirements, and to some extent, like I talked about, a little bit of vitamin requirements, you do want to use a good quality commercial pellet as a base. Now on top of that, you can add a number of different things as long as you do them in careful ways. Some people use good quality grass hay as a way for their animals to forage. You want to make sure that if you're using hay, you use grass hay and not legume hay. Now the difference between grasses and legume hays are things like alfalfa, clover hay, and down in the south you have a hay called lespediza, you may have heard about that. All of those are too rich in nutrients, and they could potentially cause a situation of microbial overgrowth inside of your tortoise. Now grass hays, I get a companion up here. Grass hays include things like Timothy, Bermuda hay, Sudan grass. That's usually around these parts we have Bermuda and Sudan because they grow pretty well in arid environments. Orchard grass is another one you might have heard of in the Midwest. And if you're ever looking for one, if you look in the feed store for things that are marketed for rabbits or horses, usually they'll have good grass hays available. Because again, your rabbit, like your tortoise, you don't want to feed it legume hay either. No alfalfa for anybody. If you can't find good grass hay, your animal won't eat it, or you don't want to feed it that. Again, a good high fiber pellet is a good alternative. So you've already got that in place. So I think you're in a really good situation as far as supporting their fiber intake. We actually use this high fiber pellet option again at the DTCC because it's just logistically really hard for them to get a pellet plus the hay plus a bunch of other things out to them. So we actually ended up choosing one of those high fiber pellets as it's just a good quick way to get all the nutrients they need in one handful, and so they could, you know, feed as many animals as they had. Now, if you want to provide what we in the zoo world call dietary enrichment or a little variety in their diet, you can offer really small quantities of greens for an animal that's having trouble with water balance. You know, sometimes folks suggest that. I would personally, if you're worried about water in your animals, I would suggest either soaking them, providing a soaking pan if they'll climb in by themselves. Some tortoises do drink water on their own as well. Or if they won't use a soaking pan, you know, you can immerse them in just a little bit of water. Really, all they need to do is get their cloaca wet to absorb that water into their system. But if you're going to use greens, use them really, really sparingly, I would recommend. Pigmented greens are better, the darker greens, because that's going to have more of the beta carotene if you do want to use that as a little bit of a dietary supplement. But you do want to watch out again because a lot of greens can have those oxalates. And so there's lists of the types of greens that are more, you know, better or worse in terms of oxalates. But really, the oxalate issue is only a big concern if you're feeding a diet that's like a ton of greens. And I wouldn't recommend that anyway for any of your animals. So, but if you've inherited an animal that you're trying to wean off of a greens-only diet, you know, and you need to kind of do that in stages, the best thing you can do for them at first is to start out shifting them to at least low oxalate greens, and that'll go a long way. And then you can continue trying to work them, you know, off of that greens-only diet. The problem with greens-only diets in general is that, you know, even though it doesn't seem like it in the whole plant, once you remove all the water from the greens, which is the first thing that's going to happen, you know, when the animal swallows it and goes into their digestive system and they get rid of that water, what remains is actually really, really high in protein and, again, really low in fiber. And so that's why, in general, I don't recommend heavy greens diets for these really strict herbivores. Yeah, do you have a question? So it depends on if you're trying for just a treat or for a little bit of extra water. Romaine is pretty good. Again, I would not come anywhere near feeding it as a sole diet because the lettuces are actually pretty low in a lot of nutrients too, but that's a good one. USDA has pretty good lists of low oxalate and high oxalate plants. So that's probably, do you have any lists on your websites? You just don't recommend greens at all?
Yeah.
Yeah. Spinach is one that's pretty high in oxalates, so I would avoid that. Yeah, cabbages tend to be pretty high. I haven't looked up kale recently, but that might be one too. But yeah. But again, as long as you're not going crazy on the greens too, you don't usually have to worry too much about this, but it does become a concern if you recently adopted an animal that is used to only that as the base of its diet. So usually what I recommend instead for especially desert tortoises or really any herbivorous tortoise, native grasses are really, really great enrichment because you can't go wrong when you're copying nature. And you guys have the advantage here being in the type of environment that native grasses grow really well. And so, you know, as long as if you're planting globe mallow or, you know, things that they're going to be eating out in the wild already, then that's a really, really good supplement to that pellet. And that could actually, you know, form the majority of their diet with the pellet in there just to make sure that you're meeting its minimum needs. The key to this, though, is to make sure that they're not toxic. And we've talked about this already a little bit in this meeting. The USDA publishes a good list of toxic plants, and also, especially for local plants that may not be all across the U.S., local university extension services have really, really good lists. You guys have a list. DTCC has a list, I think. So there's resources around to try and judge which are toxic and which aren't. And the important thing to also remember is, even if the level of toxicity isn't such that it outright kills your animal or makes it ill, these toxins can also sometimes interfere with those microbes. And so even though your animal isn't outright sick, you may be interfering with the efficiency of their digestive system functioning if you're working with plants that are even just a little bit toxic. So it's best to be safe and just avoid the toxins altogether. But there are several resources around that you can look those up. And then, again, if you want to give your tortoise a really special treat, there's a couple sitting here. You can offer them occasional offerings of despined apuntia or prickly pear. But I just make sure that it's in quantities that aren't too big. And Kathy gave a really good example of, for multiple reasons, those little pads work really well, not only because they're little, but because they have less of those oxalates. Yeah? That's a really good question. So, and this is what often hangs up a lot of folks that are feeding animals in a captive situation who have access to a grocery store. So, us humans, when we get a hold of plants and breed them, like to breed plants for consumption for the things that we like. And we like low fiber, and we like high sugar. And I'll get to it in a second, but that combination can result in a plant that's very different from what it would have been originally in its wild existence. So if you've got wild dandelion that's growing, that's probably very different in composition from, grocery store dandelion greens. So I would lean more towards the plants that you plant in your backyard as opposed to stuff that you buy in the grocery store, if that makes sense. Because we've bred really succulent dandelion greens that are a little bit different from the original product. And for that reason, actually, that's a really good segue. Thank you. For that reason, basically, no tortoise should ever be exposed to commercial fruit from the grocery store, because that's one where humans have bred them to the extreme of all kinds of sugar, no fiber practically at all. And so even in working in the zoo world, this is kind of my soapbox, because we get animals in our collections that in the wild are frugivores. They eat wild fruit. And San Diego's a really good place to talk about that lesson, because we have a lot of just native figs that grow wild. And so the composition of that fig that falls off the tree, sitting in Balboa Park just outside the zoo, is going to be vastly different from the fig that you buy in the grocery store that's been cultivated for thousands of years to what humans like. And so fruit is especially a really good source of those sugars, and that'll get your animal in trouble pretty quickly. So I wouldn't ever recommend fruit for a tortoise in general. Starchy vegetables are okay, but like the name says, there's a lot of starches in them. So we use them really, really, really sparingly at the zoo. They're actually a really good training treat for our animals. If you want to develop a program of weighing your tortoise on a regular basis, which I highly recommend, we've actually got a couple of tortoises in our collection that are trained to walk up onto a scale. And we use just a tiny, tiny piece of carrot, and they'll do anything. And it's just a teeny, tiny piece. They build a little ramp, and they just walk right up on it, and we weigh the tortoise, and we haven't had to pick them up or do anything with them. So you can use them, but just be really careful. And I would especially be sure that if you are using bits of starchy vegetables, that you're not cooking them, because the process of cooking turns the sugars that are already in it into a much more available form. So it basically converts a root vegetable into almost a fruit in the process of cooking it, and that's why sweet potato pies taste so good, because you've activated all those sugars. And then also, if you are going to feed anything out of that category, carrots are better than yams and sweet potatoes, because as the name says, sweet potatoes and yams have a little bit more sugar. Carrots. Jicama is a really good low sugar, decently high fiber for a root option, and animals still like it. So little pieces of jicama I usually recommend as good training treats, because they're pretty low-cal too. And then Kathy asked me to say a word or two, because I get asked the question too, several times, about how to feed your animal as it's going into brumation. There's a number of different opinions out there about how to feed them, and I don't have all, 100% of the answers, but like all things, I always try to think back to what's their natural history and what happens out there in the wild with, where they live. So what happens in the wild is at the end of the growing season, you see the plant community start to change in terms of its quality. You see the plants become more fibrous, there's a little bit less protein, and the abundance of plants starts to kind of die off in a slow fashion. And the key is that this is a gradual fashion out there in the wild. You know, they don't wake up one day and there's no food. It happens, you know, peters off very slowly over the course of a month or so. So it's equally prudent with your animal, if you want to mimic that that pattern, to really gradually taper off. You can start with the pellet portion of the diet because that's the highest quality portion of their diet. You can kind of taper that off. You can offer hay, which again will mimic the presence of those drier, lower quality grasses in their environment. And then a lot of times, like Kathy was talking to me beforehand, your animal will kind of choose these lower quality, less abundant types of plants already. You know, their physiology kind of tells them, okay, it's time to kind of shift over. The thing that you want to do during this time is make sure you don't offer them any treats. Like I wouldn't offer them any greens. I wouldn't offer them any starchy vegetables or really anything except, you're tapering off of your pellets. Offer some hay. You can, have access to your background, your backyard plants, which are probably kind of starting to die off themselves as well. But if you were to offer them something that was of a lot higher nutritional value, that might kind of confuse their physiology. They might say, oh, hey, maybe I'm not going into brumation. Maybe the plants are starting to come back. Because tortoises are really opportunistic. Even when it's not going into the winter, if they go through a period of low food availability, they'll brumate in what we call a facultative manner. You know, if it's in the middle of the summer and it's been a really poor growing season, sometimes they'll go underground for a couple months just in the middle of the summer if it's just really harsh conditions. So what you want to do is make sure that you're not tricking their physiology by sending mixed messages during that time of year. And you can probably start all of these steps about, again, if you're keeping a good chart of when your animal typically goes under, then you can start all that probably about a month before they go under. It's a good time to do that. And I think, that's all that I had. So I'd be happy to take any questions from anyone. Yeah?
If you're feeding your tortoise like every other day or 2 to 3 times a week, how often should they be pooping?
That's a really good question. Well, how often does yours poop? Do you know?
4 or 5 times a week.
Okay, that's probably pretty good, yeah. And this is me being a nerd, it might be a good idea to keep a chart of how often and how much to make sure that it's consistent. If they're going too much, and it depends on the size of your tortoise too, and that's why I'm waffling a little bit, it could be an indication of overfeeding, but you can also tell that through monitoring its weight and other things. But it should be defecating on a really regular basis. It's a good thing for them to keep it moving through.
Yeah. Right in front of the back door.
Yeah. It's hard in our collection because, and this is true for all hindgut fermenters, and it's for good reason. A lot of hindgut fermenters are what we call coprophagic, which is they will consume their feces sometimes. And for some animals, that's a really important adaptation because, as I said, those microbes have some good protein in it. So that's them recapturing that protein that's come back out of their GI tract. And that's really important, especially for animals like rabbits. That's super important for them. And we have a couple of desert tortoises in our collection that we're not sure how often they poop because they clean it up for us. So, it should be moving through on a pretty regular basis. And the best thing is to chart out how often, if you can, and make sure that that's consistent. Because if that pattern ever changes, then that's when a problem might be developing.
Well, that leads to the second question is, because of the shell and everything, how do you tell if they have bloat or colic? It's not like a horse's stomach that's going to get
Yeah. Hopefully you won't ever have to try to tell. And the way that I've seen that you guys feed them, I think you're in a really good situation. A lot of them are the same signs. If you have a dog and you look for the signs of bloat in your dog, you see it kind of difficulty breathing, trying to swallow but it can't. Those types of signs. It just acts like it's in distress. You're right. It is a much more it's kind of a little bit of a scary situation for an animal that's surrounded by a shell. It's not like a horse where it has room to expand. And even for a horse, it's a scary situation. Low activity, low appetite, lack of defecation, that's a good one. Things like that. And there are sites out there, like websites that can probably tell you more of that information too. But yeah, or ask your vet. That's what I would say. Talk to your vet. Yeah.
You were talking about
You want to make sure if you're feeding grass, like lawn grass, that it's not too lush for the reasons we talked about. So when I'm talking about grasses, I'm usually talking about the kind of stuff that they might encounter out in the wild. Like, you know, globalo is a type of grass. You know, these native grasses are the best thing. Timothy hay is similar in composition, actually, so that would be fine. Dry is fine. If you've got an animal that you either soak or he drinks water or, you know, somehow hydrates itself fine, then dry is usually the best. Because then you don't have any microbial growth happening in your food and stuff like that. So, yeah.
So, what are you, you're calling grass.
So.
Grass is grass only.
Right.
You're calling grass. You're calling
right.
Like the bushes, the mallow.
Yeah.
You're calling that a grass.
Yeah, so grass is a taxonomic term. It's anything in the grass family, which includes, and the way you can tell when you look at a plant, a really good way to tell is if the veins on the plant run parallel to each other on the leaf. That's typical of what we call a monocot, which is also the bigger family that grasses are a part of. Dicotyledonous plants or dicots are like shrubby plants or herb plant, and if you look at their leaves, the veins don't quite go parallel, they go in different directions. So there are a lot of things that are in the grass family, including timothy, including globe mallow, including a lot of the things that they're running into out there in the wild. And then we present them in different forms. We cut timothy and dry it down and present it as hay. We put Bermuda in our lawn and we grow that up as our lawn grass. So those are all kind of from the same family. But even, you know, like in our lawns, we can pump up the nutrients pretty good just in our lawn maintenance. And so you do want to be careful, especially when your tortoise has first come out of its burrow and it's super hungry and it's going after, and your lawn might be greening up too. You want to be a little bit careful not to let it have too much access to that super lush lawn if you've got one. Hopefully yours is escaping and then you're all good. But because the lawn, especially in the springtime when lawns are greening up themselves, there's going to be a whole lot of nutrients in the grass too. It's pretty, you see it often, not so much here, but like in the Midwest, people that have horses, they really warn against them going out after those lush spring pastures, because that's another situation where they do see horses colic sometimes when they just tank up on that fresh green grass. The new growth that comes up at the beginning of each year is actually for a grass, really pretty high in protein and a lot of other nutrients. So, do what? And so a good tactic, and that's, you know, once it's done with that spring greening, you're probably pretty okay. And also once your tortoise is used to it, you know, once their microbes have gotten used to it, you're probably good too. But like first of the year when they've just come up from the burrow and they're getting used to it, you might want to just put your grass out a little bit and let it dry off before you feed it. That'll kind of reduce the quality of it a little bit. Does that make sense? Yeah.
If I give my tortoise like a handful of desert willow blossoms, mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. And with reptiles, it's hard because they have really changeable metabolisms, and they deal with food a little. You know, it's easy with a mammal because if you overfeed them, they get overweight. Reptiles tend to respond with really different growth rates. They can also get overweight too. I would say the best way to tell is monitor its weight. And if you have an animal that you soak yourself, a really good thing to do is weigh it right before you soak it, because then you know that you're, you know, that's one hard thing too about weighing reptiles is they have that, you know, that water saved up in their bladder that can make weights a little bit variable sometimes. But if you can find a system like that where you know you're weighing them, you know, with a little bit less of that water load, like right before you soak, that's a good one. Otherwise, if you just weigh them on a consistent basis, like on the same day, same time of the week, and then just follow that. And if you see it start to take a really big uptick in weight, which might either mean that they're getting overweight or they're growing too fast, then you might need to scale back a little bit. It's really hard to say because it depends on the size that they are already, you know, and the life stage that they are already. Do it.
Yeah, mine's little, so he's okay. Only gained 3 ounces since last year. So,
and that's fine.
But like I said, but that was the 3 ounces after he ate like a whole bunch. Wow.
Yeah, and it is also important to weigh them right. You know, if they've just gone to town on a bunch of food, you probably don't want to weigh them right after that because then you're just weighing the food. But I think if anything, we err on the side of growing too fast when we have tortoises in captivity. So slow growth is fine. It's what they're made to do, you know, in the wild. So, do you have recommendations that you usually make for growth rates of tortoises?
I don't know what they are, but okay. Ours all grow too fast.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
For a female to get to usually 20 years, they say.
Yeah.
And ours get there in 6.
Yeah.
Any idea what is a safe weight loss during vermination?
Do you have recommendations that you usually say?
I find that my tortoise doesn't lose very much.
Yeah, typically if they.
Tortoise lost 3 ounces.
And how big is he overall?
He's about 8 inches.
Like, what's his weight?
He's 3 pounds, 6 ounces.
Oh, that's fine.
When he came out, he was 3 pounds, 3 ounces.
Yeah, you're totally fine.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And they're really good at, they just shut down, and so they don't really use much of their, you know, what's in their body.
He went straight from the aquarium into the burrow.
Okay.
He slept all winter.
Okay.
So he was getting fed twice a day with peas and carrots and dandelions.
Oh, God.
Way too much stuff.
Oh, God.
So then he went from that, I kind of got him to the dandelion greens and the mega diet, and then mm-hmm. he went into hibernation,
mm-hmm.
and then he came out 3 ounces later, and I was afraid because he wasn't getting fed all that much.
That's fine. You know, that's a pretty small loss in terms of how big he is overall. And even with mammals, I usually, you know, when I start to get worried about an animal is when they've lost 5% of their weight. But I think that's, like, I can't do the math on that, but it's even less than 5%.
Just like we do at night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know about you, but I don't seem to lose weight at night.
I know. I wish. Do you have a question?
Mine eat mulberry leaves.
Okay.
They are absolutely wild for mulberry leaves.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not sure, but I think they prefer them over dandelions.
Yeah, and they're probably the reason they do is because mulberry is, it's not a monocot or a grass, it's a dicot. And dicots, which are trees and shrubs and herbs, tend to have a little more protein, a little more nutritious. I think it would be fine if he's already pre-accustomed to it, then he should be okay. Again, when you get into problems with tortoises is when there's like a sudden change, when you offer them a new thing they've never seen before and tons of it. I wouldn't let him get to the berries if it ever produces fruit.
It's a wild tree.
Yeah.
I have a squashed tortoise. She came from a friend of mine whose brother allowed a woodman to pick it up and it's But when I go out and cut mulberry, you've never seen anything move so fast. She'll hear the gate go and charge in for the gate because she'll be standing there waiting when I come in with a bunch of mulberry.
And what you could probably do, what I would probably do is, rather than cut a whole bunch at once and give it to them, you know, like once a week or every other week, you might want to do little cuttings a lot more frequently. And then again, you know, keep the environment consistent in their GI tract, and that would be a nice, you know, small treat, but that's offered in a consistent fashion, that you're not having this up and down of. Mm-hmm. And can your tortoise, does it have access to the leaves that fall?
The leaves that fall, yes.
Okay, that's probably fine.
To actually let them have them, I just didn't talk.
Okay. Yeah, because just grazing on the leaves that fall is probably plenty, and that would be fine. But if you are going to cut them for them, I would, you know, do smaller, more frequent cuttings, and that probably be better than a whole pile all at once. Right.
Giving antibiotics to their tortoises for upper respiratory disease for a long period.
Right.
So they were wondering about that.
That's a really good question. First of all, I would work really closely with your vet because they're going to have really specific recommendations on how to manage them through that period. Depending on the type of antibiotic they offer, it may or may not have consequences. But in general, it does take a hit to the bacteria that live in their gut. And so usually what we do with the zoo, we manage a lot of animals that do fermentation in their GI tract as they're getting antibiotics. I work pretty closely with the vets. I know they try to limit the amount of time that they're offering it. And then as soon as they're off the antibiotic, try to just be really gradual with any diet changes that you make and try to offer, again, as consistent a diet as you can to kind of ease them back. And this is where, the practice of coprophagy or eating the feces can be a good thing because your animal can sometimes re-inoculate itself. Or if it lives with a partner, it can pick it up from its buddies. So if you have two males that are together, probably the best thing you could do for one that's been on antibiotics is put it in with the other guy, as long as he's over the infection and you're not spreading the infection. But, if you want to help him back after that period of antibiotics, you could just put him in together. And that's how young animals like mammals, like young horses and creatures like that, that's how they inoculate their gut, is just exploring their world and picking up dirt. And and that's how they get them there in the first place.
Assuming our guys are going to be individual, mm-hmm. They're not going to have access to another animal. They'll re-inoculate their gut.
They will slowly, yeah. Yeah, they just kind of pick it up from their environment. But that's, just kind of baby them through that process and don't do too extreme of diet changes and stuff. So, yeah.
The two conditions of turbidity and soft shell, are those conditions reversible with a special diet or what?
It depends how far gone it is. Unfortunately, when it's hit a certain extent, it's sometimes not reversible. We had actually a couple of animals in our collection, and this was owing to a faulty light bulb that happened in one of our enclosures. We ended up with a couple of radiated tortoises that were just starting to pyramid a little bit. But the keepers noticed it really quickly, put them out in a patio that had full sun access, and they actually are getting better. Usually if it's a young growing animal that's not too heavily affected, they can grow back out of it. Unfortunately, the pictures that I showed back there, those animals will probably always be pyramided. And even the effects of metabolic bone disease, you'll see the bone density fill back in, and that'll be good. You won't see them have soft shells or plastrons anymore, but the shape at a certain point sometimes does get set. So you want to head it off early or prevent it entirely, which, I think you guys are feeding diets that are going to prevent that. I think you do a really good job. Yeah.
So then when you see a tortoise shell that's got that pyramiding, mm-hmm. That's not a particular species, not no tortoise that should happen naturally.
Definitely not desert tortoises. There are a couple of tortoises, radiated tortoises are one of them, that do have a little bit of a pointy appearance to their shell. Radiated tortoises. They're from Madagascar. Similar environment, actually. I include them in my talk, too, because they live in a really similar dry environment. But desert tortoises should definitely look just like this one here, nice round. Sulcata tortoises, same thing. A lot of the ones that we see commonly as pets, spider tortoises sometimes have a little bit of point to their shell. So basically, radiateds and spider tortoises have a little bit of pointiness, but everybody else should be really round and smooth. That's great. That's really good. Yeah. The opposite would be bad. So we received a Galapagos tortoise into our collection last year, and when we received him, he'd been on not the best diet, and his feces were almost liquid. They were really, really runny, and that's a sign of not enough fiber in the diet. But if you're seeing a lot of hay come through your tortoise, that's perfect. Tortoise feces, again, same GI tract. Tortoise feces should look a lot like horse feces. They should be nice and formed, and if you see fiber coming through them, that's great. So, yeah. Yeah.
In the front yard of our neighbors, there's no walls. It's just about 12 feet tall. Mm-hmm. So, after the lawn, but my neighbors have oleanders.
Ooh.
And she's not attracted to the oleander.
Good.
But the dead leaves and dead flowers on the ground, she's attracted to those. If they're dead, are they...
Don't let her eat them. At all. Yeah, oleander's super toxic, even the dry form. Somebody quoted a statistic to me, but you know, it just takes like a tiny bit of a leaf to be super toxic to an animal. So yeah, is it on your property or is it your neighbor's property that your tortoise goes over to?
Yes, well, they're both, it's connected. So
okay.
You can't tell whose property it is.
Yeah.
Their property.
Yeah.
Okay.
I wonder if you could work out a system with your neighbor that you like cooperate in picking up the leaves or something. Because, yeah, I would not let them have access. Yeah. Yeah, and that's the cool part. You know, a lot of animals, you have really good senses, and a lot of toxins advertise themselves because the plant doesn't want to get eaten, and so it wants to say, hey, I'm toxic. So a lot of animals can usually detect it. The funny thing is that sometimes when an animal is living not out in its wild environment with all the same sensory cues and, you know, cycles and things like that, they can get a little bit confused, and we do see animals in our zoo settings sometimes eat things that are toxic that they should have the instincts, but they just don't because they're just in a different situation than the one that their wild instincts would fire off in. Watch your tortoise and see if it goes after the oleander, but I would just say better safe than sorry and remove it if you can. I know that's a hard situation with your neighbor, but yeah. Do you recommend particular types of Opuntia? There's a bunch of different species, but if you have one in particular that you recommend on your website, that okay. I would look that up as a good resource. Yeah, question? I would still try to work a little bit of pellet into their diet just to make sure you're covering your bases. And the pellet will help with, you know, if they're eating a whole lot of really, really fresh plants, you might not be eating quite enough fiber. The Mega Diet pellet is really good in fiber, so. Or any of the others that I, because I'm not supposed to recommend a particular diet, but the one that you guys are working with already provides a really good fiber base, so. Anybody else? Yeah.
What about
aloe vera? Off the top of my head, I cannot remember. There are some varieties that you can have problems with. I would look that up on USDA's website. There's a really good site that's mainly made for, you know, like ranchers and people with livestock, but it has a really good reference of toxic plants, and it'll probably list some of those succulents. Anybody else? Okay. Well, thank you.
100%. Jennifer, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Wasn't that fantastic? My gosh. Jennifer doesn't know this, but I quote her all the time, don't I? Yes, I do. The few things that I remember, you know. But maybe now with all these people remembering, it'll be great. And would you like, can we give you one of our new t-shirts?
Oh, are they new? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they're magic.
One of the last ones, but yeah. Sure.
Oh, but this is a magic t-shirt.
Oh, yeah.
It turns, it. If you haven't seen it, when you go out in the UV, the colors all...
Oh, cool.
Pop out. Yeah, the tortoise.
Yes,
it's wonderful. Well, thank you so much for this wonderful time. And we'll see you next month, and we're going to talk about all about habitats. Janina and I are. So have a good month, and we'll thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.